It's getting close to the end of the day, and I hope that what I'm going to talk about actually will give you some food for thought. I was given the title, Do Consumers Care About the Recycled Content? I'm taking the recycle out. Do they care about content at all, is the question, really. So that is the answer. So I can pretty well sit down. They do not care. We'll explore that a bit more and unpick it, but in essence, when we talk about the very, very subject of the recycled content, actually, we've seen a whole lack of interest in that. They're actually much more interested in other things. We have a huge collection of diversity of population. These populations come with different cultures. We're seeing increasingly within the European Union, more people coming in who are coming from countries that do not have recycling facilities. They're bringing that habit with them. Communities that are actually to the community detriment, and we're having to re-educate as these things happen. And on the other hand, we've got a really good setup going on with things like Wastebusters who are visiting schools on a regular basis, teaching young kids that actually this so-called waste is actually a resource that you should do something with in the future, and therefore they need to be engaged with that process. And we'll come back and touch on that a bit later. This slide I put in because this is the Maslow's hierarchy of need as it is assigned to people's attitude to their own business. So you could actually think about your own company and think about where you are on that scale if you want. If you don't want to listen to me, that might give you some feelings about what you should be doing about your next job change. On the other hand, if we apply this model to where people are in their own lives and we look across the far side, that kind of roughly equates to where people are in their habits of recycling and actually reuse and how engaged they are. So they're almost engaged about here, sense of belonging, I'm good at my job, I don't understand how I impact greater community though. And slowly as they become more and more astute and more professional in their job, well, as we become more and more self-aware, then we start realising we ought to be engaged with things like wildlife and so on and so forth. And we see the impact that what we do has on the planet. And therefore, in the context of today's talks, it is then my responsibility to the supply chain, the recycling part of it. The Guardian did an article a couple of years ago, and they did a big survey, and we were part of the interview, where they asked, you know, what were the 10 top things consumers were conscious of? What were they really worried about? And in no particular order, these things came out, that the consumers value certification. So when they see something like FSC or World Wildlife Fund on the back of a pack, that actually, they're not quite fully sure what that means, but they know it means that somebody's taken some care over it. Second part then is ethical supply chains touch the heart. Yes, we'd love to be feeling that we're engaged with that, but actually when it comes to it, if it costs me more, I'm probably not going to do it. And actually the head often is disconnected with the heart on this particular matter. Telling emotive stories. It's one of the big disappointments with Plan A, Marks & Spencer, is that we don't talk about it enough. Plan A has been part of our business for 10 years. It generates £187 million of profit each year doing the right thing, but we don't tend to talk about it a great deal. And that's a bit of a shame, but there's a lot of companies in the same boat. And I noticed that, you know, Levers have started to talk a bit more about their policies of the global brand, Coca-Cola themselves, being a bit more public about their social currency now. But it's got to be really authentic because, my goodness, the Daily Mail will find it if it isn't. Brands should do the work so that consumers don't have to. And this is one big thing that obviously we're all painfully aware of. I expect the brand to do it. And back in the late 80s, early 90s, when we were talking about recycled content, we were talking about environmentally friendly soap powders, it was assumed that the big boys would do it. The Procter & Gamble and Levers were actually going to do this for me. I didn't have to chase it. They'll be on it, won't they? And in fact, on occasions, they tripped up because they weren't doing it. And actually, again, a story hit the press, and that then caused brand damage. So it has to be really authentic. And also, the brands need to do it, and we are very conscious of that at Marks & Spencer. Product categories matter. People are more engaged about the environmental impact of food packaging than they are of toiletries. One of the big things we found being involved with Pledge for Plastics campaign is actually recycling packaging from food is relatively straightforward. And when I say food, I mean beverages as well. When you go into the bathroom, very little of that is getting into the recycle bin. And there's now a big push to tell people that that also is legitimate recycled material, or recyclable material, sorry. Packaging doesn't always tell the full story. You mentioned earlier on the OPRL labels. We, year before, we had to undergo, in the food business, a thing called FIR, Food Information Regulations, something that came from Europe, and it said that all pack copy must be a minimum of 6 point. And that took away huge amounts of space on the back of the pack. So we had to create a hierarchy of information on the back of the pack because we have legal requirements on nutrition, legal requirements on allergens, and lo and behold, OPRL, the on-pack recycling logo, is not a legal entity. So guess which one dropped off the pack? And we struggle, we really fight to try and keep that on the back of the label, but I know other retailers have had the same dilemma. We don't want to expand our packaging to get all this information on. We don't want to make it bigger because actually we're trying to keep our packaging to a minimum. We want to tell people stories about how to do their recycling properly, but actually we're being confined by all the other things we have to do legally. So that, I think, is a bit of a challenge. Then there's this black hole. We mentioned the Wastebuster campaign. There is definitely a gap between 14 and 25 where litter proliferates and where recycling stops. There's a disconnect with a generation there, or that age quota. They just don't really care, unless they come from a family who really have it on their agenda up here. And how do we get them back? How do we keep them? And then how do we get them back quickly? And then sustainability should be a must, not a maybe. And I think, you know, we've all gathered from today that that is what's coming. Sustainable design is not now an option. It is something we have to do. I'll return to that in a minute. And then there's always the conundrum between price and value. What does that mean? How do consumers read price? If I put the thing up for £2, because it's a much more sustainable pack, they won't read that as being something of value. They'll say you just put the price up. Even though it made the pack more recyclable, that will not be for them anything that they want to deal with. So, the reason I put this lovely slide up is only because I like it, okay? But it demonstrates the point. If you have a particular characteristic, a trait, it will come through in the generations, and you can see it very clearly. So if we make a mistake down here, it will have its repercussions. And that's what we're living with right now. Back in the mid-80s, Margaret Thatcher released the handbrake on all of our contracted services and gave it to the private sector. And we have gone into a freefall of different systems and ways of doing things. And we don't have this cohesive thing in the middle pulling us together around one principle. And that really is why we're having the struggle we have at the moment. Fundamentally, the DNA has actually been disconnected. And we need to bring it back together. And Paul's made a point about that. We need to somehow bring this back. And I'm fond of using the phrase, we need a czar in the middle somewhere. And it could have been wrapped. That RAP has sort of gone into different spaces. It could be DEFRA. It could be the minister, but the minister doesn't hang around long enough. You know, somebody has to say, guys, line up, get this thing sorted. Start talking about the same thing. Right, I'm going to change tack now. Anybody sail in the room? No, one person sails, well done. You again.
sporty bloke,
Keith. A sporty bloke, Keith, yeah, I know. Anybody know who's on that boat? Well done, well done. She sailed around the world in 83 days on this boat. And while she went round, she took everything she needed with her on that boat. She didn't throw a thing over the side. She lived off everything that was on board, and she recycled a lot of it to actually keep herself alive in that period. Okay. While she was out there, she also saw a lot of junk floating on the ocean. And in her head, while she was sitting there in the quiet moments, she put these two bits together and said, how come I can live sustainably on a boat like this, and yet all this stuff is in the water? And that's when she came back in this epiphanal moment that she relates to, where she started the foundation. And the foundation has actually gone on to produce the circular economy butterfly, which has been referenced already. And it's about how we think about our use of materials, whether it be a natural material, biological material, whether it be a technical material. We have to keep those materials in circulation as long as we can. Now, it's impossible to keep them in there up there forever because entropy exists. Second law of thermodynamics won't allow for it. But the more we use a material once extracted from the soil or the earth, the better it is all round. And that circularity has got to be built into the way we now do things. And at Marks & Spencer, it is one of our objectives this year to actually say to all of our suppliers, unless you show evidence that you're doing this, we ain't going to use you anymore. You've got to prove to us that you've got this on your agenda. It's no good waiting another 2 or 3 years, because circularity is probably the only way we're going to get this moving.
Eventually, obviously, the material will drop out of the system,
and then we have to decide what we do with that material. Do we burn it for energy, or does it return to the biosphere with a zero effect? That is about material design. They have suggested that this is the model, the strategy, is that we recycle about 50% of everything we do. We look for 30% of fundamental design innovation, which actually changes the characteristic of the packaging, and then 20% we reuse. That's kind of their model, and that might count and overlay some of the things we heard earlier about maybe a DRS system where it works. This is actually more about actually different types of material and then the recycled content. This is the grave reality of the materials we use. I'm a great fan of plastic. Actually, if we weren't a great fan of plastic, we tried to live a plastic-free life, most of us would be naked or semi-naked in this room right now. Most of us have got polyester. The chairs themselves would be just the metal frames. And actually, the metal wouldn't be here because they've gone through rolling mills which have got nylon bearings, etc., etc., etc. The world would not be as it is now. So let's not demonize plastic, but let's just recognize we have undervalued it as a material. So if you look at the holes that have been dug around the world on a regular basis for all the other materials we use, it's pretty shocking. Driving along the north coast of Spain, if you go to the northwest corner where a lot of the Rioja vineyards are, you will see sides of mountains missing for the glass industry. They will never come back. At least with a rig, it's out of sight. It's down underneath. Okay, we're exploiting the resource and it's going to run out, fine. But it's not doing quite the damage that all this is. And even when we take the Gulf of Mexico into account, it's still not leaving scars this big on the landscape. The only thing that isn't doing the damage is plantation of trees. So the board industry have actually got to this in the 70s because they were chased quite heavily. And what were they chased by? Well, the chasing resulted in FSC, the Forest Stewardship Council. And they are managing now their resource. So for every acre of trees they cut down, 3 acres go in. So it's actually now become a very sustainable material. Cartonboard mills we use are all FSC, and each of those mills have their own power generation on site. They're using their own biomass to generate the energy they use. So it's self-contained. It can be done. And I think it's just taking that thinking and applying it to other materials. And it's interesting, I was talking earlier that we were at an international sustainability unit workshop about 4 weeks ago, and along with Coca-Cola and others. And one of the outcomes of that workshop was that there should be a plastics or a polymer stewardship council, one that actually concerned itself with the handshakes in the process, so that there was a dialogue going on between all of the handshakes and the circularity of it. And the outshot would be that if we, Marks & Spencer, wanted to have a piece of plastic in for our packaging, unless it bore a PSC badge, we ain't going to be buying it from you. Which means the onus is on you, Mr. Plastic Supplier, Mr. Converter, Mr. Recycler, to make sure you've joined up the story, to make sure that plastic is actually legitimately a PSC material. Now, it's a long way off, and we probably won't see this for 4 or 5 years if FSCs only to go by, but I think it's a worthy ambition to go after. And there is a product stewardship council in Canada which actually has already started some of this work for products. So coming back to some basics, this is a very kind of primary school illustration, but our concern should be what we're leaving behind. A couple of 100 million years ago, deposits were laid down that we have exploited in terms of coal and oil. What we're doing today is locking up carbon as we make polymers, and we are putting them in places that can't be recovered. And that really is the bit about the recycling. If we can get this stuff back and use it again, we can do something with it without exploiting any more of what's under the ground. And that statistic alone is enough to show that we've got a resource out there to go after. And it's a great resource. You know, it hasn't deteriorated. We've been told time and again it lasts 100 years. Great, great. That means it's there to go and get. There is talk of in Belgium of actually exploiting old landfill sites, looking for materials that have been put down there 40 years ago. Not necessarily polymers, but metals and so on. I know that the Scottish government were looking at the same model. So mining this material could be a very rich resource. Customer, on the other hand, doesn't need to know. Actually, if you tell them about it, they will just get very angry and very confused. What they want us to do is do this for us. They will get very agitated when they hear we're not doing it, because somebody like the Daily Mail or the Daily Express will tell them. And it will get into the metro, and then thousands of people on the underground in London will actually be able to tell you that we're not doing our job. Actually, we probably all are, but we're just not working on it hard enough in terms of our own PR. And this comes to another point, is that if we are truly to do this cohesively, we don't just need to engage ourselves as retailers and customers and recyclers and processors. We need to also engage people like marketing professionals. People who can take the story and actually can make that story into a positive. This is the one thing I believe we've forgotten to do, because there are some incredibly positive stories in this already. And we're not telling anybody. We're just sitting there doing it and trying to do the right thing, and all the government here is the negative stories. We should be engaging in marketing of this process. Because ultimately, that's what the customer wants. They want what's in it, not what's under it. Nobody goes into a store to buy a plastic tray. They go in to buy sausages and burgers and whatever for the summer's day. As soon as they're on the barbecue, we now have a thing that, in their view, is waste. What I see is just it's carbon captured, ready for me to do something with extra. And I'm interested in how we get that back to us in the most efficient way. And we have to simplify that, because they look at that and say, well, my council told me black's no good. And I hear we had a big discussion about black earlier on. Right, okay. Shall we have the definitive story on that one? Right. We've got time. This project's been going on for 7 years. Okay. Marks and Spencer and Waitrose looked at actually the viability of recycling CPET back 7 years ago. We tested it at the Imperial College. We showed that actually it was quite okay to bring back round the cycle and put into the recycled content in a CPET tray. Thumbs up, everybody said great. And then we had another collaborative project with RAP, and we put together a team with a recycler, with two retailers, with Nextech and with FEC Plastic and one of our big food suppliers. And we put 4.5 million trays on the market, and we went and got them back, and then we put them through a reprocessing with lots of little grey areas in there. I can't tell you about this. I won't tell you about the detail now, but if you want to hear it afterwards. We did have some hiccups along the way, but we did actually prove that that material could be put through a standard waste stream, and we could get it back and we could reuse it. The hiccup has been, is that when we went to then all the retailers and said, should we just do this? One particular retailer put their hands up and said, I don't think we want to do this because competition rules. And actually, when we looked at it legally, there is no competition rule that applies to this. We could have done it, but there was a blocker. So we've come back to it 4 weeks ago. We got everybody in the room and we said, when are we going to do this? And this time the blocker has been our producer, because the producer has now grown in stature. They are now owning 80% of the marketplace. They do not want to move out of carbon black, because it will upset their factory. And we're saying, okay, well, why is that an issue? You know, well, because carbon black is cheap. And actually, they're working on such thin margins that if we decide to go into the detectable dyes, it's going to change their financial model. So right now, we're saying, yes, it's a great idea, but we're not going to help you do it. So that's another little challenge. So every time we get close to doing something about this, we get a little blocker. And right now, We're certainly working very hard on getting that block undone. And there are a couple of things happening in the pipeline that will, we hope, shove it forward big time. But it is there to do, and it can be done. We just got to show that there's a worth in doing it and there's a value in it. And with 80% recycled content in every single CPET tray, why shouldn't we be doing it? I hope that answers that. This statement is just one about our determination on sustainable design. It's basically to maximise the way in which packaging works around food, but actually also in the most environmentally sustainable way we can. We mustn't forget that ultimately the reason we use packaging is because we want to protect food in the supply chain. What's more iniquitous than plastic going into a landfill is actually food that goes in a bin. And 24% of all the food we produce in the UK gets binned at home. Okay? So the supply chain also is responsible for a lot of waste, but actually the more packaging we use, actually the less waste we have. So I was dealing with a thing about broccoli in cellophane bags yesterday. Actually, the broccoli goes 7 days longer if you put it in a bag, which actually cuts down food waste. You get 2 weekend sales, you get rid of it to the customer. We've really got to be careful that we don't over-egg this and say, you know, it's all about the packaging. It isn't. The packaging is doing a phenomenally important role. So, very, very briefly, this is the Marks & Spencer strategy for, now some of you may have seen this, but essentially we're going down three channels: healthy materials, optimised packaging, and then healthy supply base. And in each of these columns, we're going to try, or we are going to insist, in fact, that our suppliers help us produce packaging that actually conforms to these pillars. Underneath, you can see the Plan A attributes we've assigned to that, some of which is about plastic promotion, some of it is about actually making sure that we've got a continuous programme of packaging reduction, but not just. So far with it, we end up with a piece of packaging that doesn't do its primary job, which is to protect the food and drink. Another piece that we're looking at is actually to do with a polymer, the type of polymer we might use. And we have gone public saying that we would like to be, by 2025, only in one plastic for packaging. Okay? It's a huge ask, but we believe there are things happening in the trade that actually will help us get there. We want to make that one polymer one that recycles absolutely with highest efficiency. We want to make sure that polymer can be derived from a biological source. We also want to make it an improved polymer in terms of protection for food. So there are candidates, one of which is PEF, polyester furanate, which behaves exactly the same way as polyester terephthalate. The only snag is that the two are not compatible in the recycle chain. So there is a bit of work to be done on that. And one of the pieces of work, just so you don't go into, oh, Marks & Spencer are going to screw it all up for us. There is a way we can actually affect the material so it shows up under IR very clearly. So it will actually can be selected out. But 50% recovered, so always having recycled content. We are suggesting that actually 50% might be the maximum. The reason for that is, again, second law of thermodynamics. All the physics says if you keep putting recycled content in, your waste stream will deteriorate. And therefore, by keeping it 50%, you are going to be adding in new material throughout. So the theory is we actually end up with a better quality waste stream. And this has been borne out by the work being done on the new plastics economy with the Ellen MacArthur Foundation. How much of a percentage of grown and how much of a percentage of mined in the interim, that is up for debate. Right now, we couldn't do very much with the grown stuff because it actually, as Coke know, costs a lot more to do. And we can't quite get there on 100%. So there is going to be mined material for a while. But there is going to be a point at which then fossil fuels will no longer be required. And here are the alternative sources. There's maize, there's rice, there's sugarcane, cassava starch, there's anaerobic digestion. And then there's this new light technology you may have heard of where they're making polymers out of CO2 and methane, which is a thing that's happening in the States at the moment. Sugarcane, the sugar market at the moment is on the decline. There's a lot of sugar available. Sugarcane is actually a very, big, very good source material for creating ethanol. Just some quotes from some people who may be represented in this room, all of which sound very, very good. Please, the plea is get that down to the trucks. Get that down to the people actually on the ground. Get them to believe it. because that's at the moment the slight weakness in it, is the fact that it's all believed at the top end. It's not filtered all the way down just yet. We're already doing quite good things, aren't we? Let's big it up a bit. We've got, actually, I don't quite know what's happened. There's overlaid on a picture. Okay, there's, let's go back on that. Oh, it just shows I can't use my blinking iPad, doesn't it? Where's it gone? I'm going to exit that and come out and go back. Because, there you go. So, recycled content in a lot of things already. And on the far side, we've got a recycled carton box, glass, steel, aluminium, and behind them some plastic. And IKEA's bottles that were launched last year, mixed glass. And then a hotel reception desk made, well, in fact, a Holiday Inn made entirely out of recycled material. Right, so very quickly, we have a long way to go. These things are very much part of kind of the dialogue at the moment, as has been alluded to. Ocean plastics are going to be a big thing this year. Sky Television have made it their campaign of the year. We will see it over and over again. His Royal Highness Prince Charles has decided that it is his campaign for the year as well. We will keep being challenged on this. It is part of the problem. The first piece of the problem is stopping people doing it in the first place. The second part is recovering what's out there and using it. And if we can put a value on it, then that's worth doing. Two people we have, Plastic Bank, encourage you to go and look at their website, enabling communities around the world now to pick up plastic from seashores, and they are then facilitating the plastic being put back into the recycled stream. And then over here in Greek Island, they are paying the fishermen to go and fish for plastic rather than fish. So that is, they go out with their nets, instead of catching fish for the day, they go and scoop the plastic up and then resell it. Anybody heard of this company, Recycling Technologies? Yeah, Keith has, I know that. Recycling Technologies, really, I feel this is a really exciting development. This is basically a piece of kit that you bolt on the back of a MRF for all that waste and strains plastic that you can't capitalise on going out through the gate. And effectively, you put it in here, and it's basically a steam catalyzer, and it generates a thing called Plax, which is plastic wax. And that plastic wax is three times the value of the original source material, but it also can be used exactly the way you would use crude oil to make new plastics or new materials. And they are, they've just put this in at Hills in Swindon. The pilot plant is now active alongside a working MRF. So we're going to see how well that generates. But there is a forecast to put one of these machines into a waste facility in Scotland very shortly. In fact, it'll be online in 2018. This is quite interesting because it actually valorises everything. If you put one of these alongside, you don't throw any plastic away anymore because you can turn it back into this. This actually makes money for you. The cost of the pilot plant was £3 million. It will pay itself back. Puts out 7,000 tonnes. It will pay itself back in 4 years. So there's some interesting metrics in there as well. So coming back to the consumer dialogue, just making a virtue about recycled content is not going to work. Using recycled materials must be viewed as using a new resource. So whether it's collecting curbside, whether it's going to the dump, whatever, let's try and make the connections between what they're doing here with what they see being output. We've done it with Schwab, where we recycle clothing back into polyesters. Will I Am has done it with his brand EcoCycle, which has been incredibly successful in the States. He's making really trendy clothes out of recycled material, and barely talks about the recycled content anymore. It's all about the program on the ground with the ghetto. It's not about the actual content. And this boat is called Plastiki. This is made of recycled content. This is bottles made into a boat which they sell around the world. If you can see an object, you can see something that's actually a manifestation of the process. I think the consumers start to really get it. If you're interested, come see me quickly afterwards. Sustainable free tool now online out of the Ellen MacArthur Foundation called the Circular Design Guide, and it is just literally www.circulardesignguide.com. Go on there, the password has been taken away, it's free access. And on there are 24 different tools that you can use to design with sustainable design. So you can actually start unpicking anything really, from a car design to a piece of packaging. We've been involved in the development of that, and we've started to use it with our suppliers as well. It's proven quite useful. So the final slide is this. These guys in the Philadelphia Mineral Company found black, ghastly sludge. And when they came away from the rig, they were covered in this stuff, and they exploited it initially as a replacement for whale oil, for running lamps in homes. And they made kerosene out of it. And the kerosene was actually the thing that replaced the whale oil. But then a man called Henry Ford came along and said, ha-ha, I think I might have a use for that. Can you just make it a little bit more refined for me? And then we got gasoline. And the rest, as they say, is history. Can we be the new pioneers? I think we can.